Welcome to worship. My name is Heidi Henkel. I am the pastor of Bethesda Presbyterian Church, and it's a joy to worship with you today. Wherever you are listening from today, whether it's through your car radio in our parking lot, on our live stream through the website, on our Zoom line with the fellowship group, or on Facebook, we want to welcome you. Today, we are going to be celebrating the sacrament of communion as part of our worship. And so I invite you to gather some bread and juice from your kitchen today, if you haven't already, and put them near you on a table so that you're ready when it comes for that moment when we gather around the table virtually. Today, we light our second candle of Advent, the love candle. And to lead us in lighting our Advent wreath this week, we have Candy and Paul and Ashley. Let's center ourselves and begin.
Our lives are long, even in the strangeness where we live these days, and we want to do it right. We want to be safe, but we want to be able to enjoy the season. We've got work to do to put right what has gone wrong, to heal what is broken, to mend the relationships, and to do prepare for the company that will come.
The prophet Isaiah reminded us that there is work to be done. Prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. When God comes in, then healing is to be found. But we need to make the way. We need to open the door into our lives.
So we light these candles as a sign of our faith that the God we worship is not far from us, and that we can clear the way for that God is to come and dwell with us. We light these candles in faith that the company is coming.
O come, Emmanuel.
Join me in our call to worship. Listen, the voice of God calls out across the ages. We hear and respond. We rise to worship God from the cities, the suburbs, the small towns and mountains. Like a shepherd, God leads us and tenderly gathers us together. Comfort, comfort my people, says our God of love. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Let's pray. O God, you call us from the wild places. You call us from the inner chambers of our hearts. We come in answer to your call. We come to pray, to praise, to learn of your love for all creation. Reveal your glory that we may see it together. Inform and inspire us to seek your kingdom on earth and in our time. Amen. We invite you to join us in singing our opening worship song.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing, love so Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel,
We have sinned before God and others. Yet we also know that if we confess our sin, we can be restored to a right and a just standing before God. This means we have to recognize the damage we've done to ourselves, to others, and to God. Let's confess our sin, trusting God's promised mercy. Join me in our prayer of confession. O God, we confess that far too often we find ourselves stuck, overwhelmed, or aimless, trapped by fears and anxieties that paralyze us, constraining our actions. Simple acts of compassion, of connection with others, are enormously difficult, and sometimes anger, even rage, takes us hostage, and we treat others as enemies, failing to discern your beloved image in them. Free us from fear and anger so that we can love without restraint, so that we may be compassionate
as you are compassionate, because we are your children. Amen. Friends, hear the good news of the gospel. God's grace is stronger than any anger and fear that may hold us in their grip. God's grace liberates us, freeing us to live in love and compassion. Thanks be to God. God has given us resources, talents, and life itself. So let's respond by offering our gifts, our time, our money, and our lives to God as instruments of God's service. Let's pray. God, we offer our gifts to you, that they may be used to further the promise of hope, peace, love, and justice in our community and in our world. Empower us, O God, to follow these gifts into our community and world, so that they and we may become bearers of peace, love, and justice on this earth. We ask this in your name. Amen. Welcome to Kids Time. Let's listen closely to hear what God says to us today. You might be wondering why we have the lights down tonight. We're showing Zoe what a flashlight is. Have you ever used a flashlight before? Maybe you've done that when the lights have gone out, or maybe you've done it around the campfire if you've ever camped out before. Well, we're talking today about the light of God. See, God says that the world was in a really dark place, right? People were hurting each other. There wasn't a whole lot of love. There wasn't any belief in God. The people had just given up. They were in a really dark place. They didn't have much hope left. And so God said, I'm going to send my light of the world. He's going to send his light. And he sent Jesus. And when Jesus comes into the world, he says, you know what? You want to share some of my light? Love. Love each other. Now, how does love become light? What do you think, Zoe? How does love become light? It's pretty simple. When we share our light with one another, the same way we share love, things get a little bit brighter. I'll tell you what I mean. Have you ever noticed that love is contagious, or that joy is contagious? That sometimes when you get laughing, other people get laughing? Yeah? Have you ever noticed that when you share something you really like with somebody else, they think it's neat too? Have you ever noticed that when you come over and give somebody a piece of hope or a piece of love, you give them a hug, let's say, or you give them encouragement, it helps others to feel better. Yeah, you don't want to stare straight into the light, Zoe. It's a little bright, right? It's a little bright. Thank you. Did you just share your light with me? You want me to share the light with you again? Very good. We feel happy. We feel happy that people want to share with us, that they want to bring their light and their love. So you get to share this week. I want you to find a way in which you can share. Thank you, Zoe. Apparently she wants to share my microphone this week. You want to say hi? You want to say hi to everybody? I want you to try and find something that you can share. Whether it's calling somebody and sharing a joke with them to make them laugh. Or whether it is being kind and encouraging to somebody. Or even if it's just sharing your favorite toy with a sibling. I want you to find a way in which you can share your light and love with the people that you love this week. Because when we love one another, we bring the light of Christ. You want to pray with me, Zoe? Shall we pray? Dear Jesus, Help us to realize how to light up the world, how to make things a little bit brighter so that we can walk in this journey of life together. We can see where we're walking, see those who are struggling, and see how God wants us to help. We ask this in your name. Amen. Thanks for joining us for Kids Time. We invite you to sing our next hymn with us. You want to say bye? Our scripture reading today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 1, verses 1 through 24. Hear the word of God from the book that we love. This is a genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, Isaac the father of Jacob, Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers, Judah the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar, Perez the father of Hezron, Hezron the father of Ram, Ram the father of Aminadab, Aminadab the father of Nahshon, Nahshon the father of Salmon, Salmon the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab, Boaz the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth, and Obed the father of Jesse, and Jesse the father of King David. David was the father of Solomon, whose mother was the wife of Uriah. Solomon the father of Rehoboam, Rehoboam the father of Abijah, Abijah the father of Asa, Asa the father of Jehoshaphat, Jehoshaphat the father of Jehoram, Jehoram the father of Uzziah, Uzziah the father of Jotham, Jotham the father of Ahaz, Ahaz the father of Hezekiah, Hezekiah the father of Manasseh, Manasseh the father of Amon, Amon the father of Josiah, and Josiah the father of Jeconiah and his brothers at the time of the deportation to Babylon. After the exile to Babylon, Jeconiah was the father of Shealtiel, Shealtiel the father of Zerubbabel, Zerubbabel the father of Abihud, Abihud the father of Eliakim, Eliakim the father of Azor, Azor the father of Zadok, Zadok the father of Akim, Akim the father of Elihud, Elihud the father of Eleazar, Eleazar the father of Mathan, Mathan the father of Jacob, and Jacob the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary. And Mary was the mother of Jesus, who was called the Messiah. Thus there were 14 generations in all from Abraham to David, 14 from David to the exile to Babylon, and 14 to the exile to the Messiah. This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this
an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Welcome once again. I wanted to make one announcement before we get into our message time. If you would still like to add a Christmas greeting into our newsletter for the congregation, you can do so. They'll be going in the newsletter that's coming out between Christmas and New Year's. So if you'd like to do that, please contact our office by phone or by email to do that. I was reflecting today about what are some of the things that we do when we know that company is coming to our house. What do we do? What do you do if you have new worshipers coming or visitors coming even to your church? I think the answer is we clean up, right? We clean up. If we know the company is coming over, I think we begin to clean up the rooms that we know company is going to be in, right? We start to take the mess and either shove it into closets or put it in another room or clean up and organize. We try to straighten up. We try to clean up any of the messes, put the dishes away, put the food away, right? We try to get out any footprints or any dirt that's been left around, the dust. Why do we do this? Why do we really get anxious about doing this when we know the company is coming? I think it's for a couple of reasons. I think we're trying to do it to be presentable, right? We certainly don't want people to think that we live like animals, right? So we try to do it to present ourselves in the best light. I think we're doing it for hygienic purposes, certainly in the middle of a pandemic. Hygiene is a big factor, right? We certainly don't want to make other people sick because they come into a house that isn't clean. I think another piece, though, is we really want people to be non-judgmental about it. We want to present ourselves as respectable people because we know that if people saw how we really lived, they would judge us. Right? If people saw who we really were and how we really lived, there would be a lot of judgment coming towards us. I think that's true. I think there's a vulnerability inside of us at allowing people to see who we really are on the inside. And we feel very vulnerable about letting anybody see who we are on the inside because maybe we don't like ourselves. Or maybe because we're carrying around a lot of guilt and shame. You know, God looks at our estate and he sees all of that. He sees all of it and he responds. In today's passage, we are given the lineage of Jesus through his father's line. Okay, so this is the paternal line of Jesus, and they're telling it to us. And in this piece, as they're naming each people, it gives us 14 generations from Abraham to David. It gives us 14 generations from David to the deportation to Babylon. And then there's 14 generations from the deportation to Jesus. God looks at our estate. He has been waiting and looking and watching each generation after each generation after each generation. Turn to him, turn away from him. Come back to him, turn away from God. Come back to him, turn away from God. He has been watching this cycle over and over and over again. He is watching us clean up our house and then completely destroy it again, and then cleaning up the house and destroying it again. He is watching this cycle of humanity, and he finally says, this is it. This is it. Now's the time. And he says, I'm stepping in. Wow. Let's take a look at what God chooses to step into. This lineage of Christ that is named here in our scripture today carries a lot of characters in it. You know, you would think that the God of all power and all authority, the God of perfection, the God who is omniscient, all-knowing, that this God would come into a family that has earned it. He would come into a family that has been holy and righteous, would come to a family that is deserving of the name of the parents or the family of Christ. But that's not what our God does. Our God comes into a lineage that is racked with people who have abused power in the worst possible forms. In this lineage, it starts with Abraham. Abraham, who takes his servant and forces her to have sex, and they bear a child. Bear a child in place of his wife, because they were so afraid that his wife would not be able to bear a child. So let's just start with Abraham there and the problem there. Then we get to Jacob. Jacob steals the inheritance. Jacob steals the birthright by deceiving his father. He steals his brother's inheritance and birthright. That's Jacob. We get to Judah. Judah sold his brother into slavery and then has sex with his daughter-in-law. And the child from his daughter-in-law in that incestuous relationship becomes one in the line of Jesus. This is not a great start. We move along and we come to a particular character, Salmon, who fathers a child with Rahab. Rahab was the head of a brothel, not by choice. She really didn't have any other moment after she had already been used by other men. They are the parents of Boaz. And then comes David. Great King David. David murders Uriah. And then he rapes Uriah's wife, Bathsheba. In fact, it even says in Scripture that David has a son by the wife of Uriah. They specifically name that Bathsheba was Uriah's wife, not David's. It keeps going on and on and on. David's son Solomon has so many wives, but he also has a tremendous amount of sex slaves. That's what concubines were. They were sex slaves. They existed for simply the pleasure of the king. Solomon, as wise as he was, as blessed as he was, he abuses his power. We have this lineage of over and over again, and this is a swath and a picture of humanity. I'm not singling these people out today of see how bad they are. I'm singling them out to say, see how awful we are. They are a picture of us. And they give in at some of the worst moments to their own impulses. Impulses that you and I are offered and subjected to every day. This is the beauty and the awesome creation of God. Really heinous stuff in this lineage that God says, I'm now going to step into. And God decides now it's time to clean house. Surely the strong arm of the Lord will come in and take care of this problem, right? Surely he is going to flex his muscles and flex his might, and he is going to deal with this problem in humanity. God's coming. The prophecies have foretold it, and even the people are aware of it. And I'm going to be honest with you, even some of the people were scared about what God was going to do. God is all powerful. He has all the authority in the world, and he has said, enough's enough. And we know how serious this is because even King Herod was scared. Even King Herod was scared of God coming into humanity. Why? Because Herod would lose the ability to use his own power to do what he wanted. Herod would lose the ability to abuse his own power. And we're going to follow up with that story in a few weeks. But I want to stay focused right now on what's in front of us here. You would think that God is going to come and clean house and use all of his power and authority to do it in the way that you and I would. He's going to take the mess. He's going to put it out of sight. He's going to erase any evidence of the sin and the stain. And he is going to make it look pretty and be done. But instead, God empties himself. God empties himself, and he takes on the form of a bond servant. He takes on the form of an indentured servant. He takes on the form of one who owes something. He takes on this form, and he comes as a baby. How backwards is that? I mean, let's just back up for a minute. You and I have heard the Christmas story so many times. We're like, yeah, he comes as a baby. But I need you to back up for a minute and hear this with new ears. The God of all power and all authority says, it's time for me to come and clean house. This sin, this abuse, this misuse of power, it's gotten way too much. It's time for me to put an end to it. I need to come now. And so you would think that he would come in that kingly fashion or in a way that's going to handle it. And he shows up as a baby. I mean, plot twist, here we are. He comes in the most vulnerable way possible. And in our scripture tells us today that he is to be called the Messiah, which means anointed one. Anointed one. This isn't just any baby. This is one who has blessing. Completely vulnerable, but he has blessing. Out of our heinous human nature, out of our murderous impulses, out of our hearts, out of our misuse and our abuse, out of our contempt for those less than us, out of our worst impulses as human beings, comes the most powerful God. Comes the most powerful God and the most helpless and powerless and vulnerable child. And he doesn't come in just a powerless, vulnerable child. He comes in a powerless and very vulnerable situation. Which brings us to the next part of our scripture today. It tells us that Mary and Joseph were engaged to be together. All right? So they were fiancés. Isn't that sweet? They were fiancés. Mary and Joseph, right? Their families were all excited. They're going to get married. Think about all that excitement that the families have around this. You know, they're already making wedding plans. Mary's family is probably putting together a dowry because that's what families did at that point. They're already planning what it's going to be. Mary and Joseph are young love. They're teenagers in love. Can't wait to be. And in the middle of that, Mary gets pregnant. Whoo. That's a conversation that's hard. You now have to come home and not just tell your own family, not just tell Joseph, not just tell Joseph's family, but it's something you can't hide. It is something you can't hide. And the one thing we know about our world and us as human beings is we have a tendency to ridicule the sins and the stains, the things that we see that are wrong, because we can see them. Did you ever notice that the things that people are most vocal about are the sins that we see, but we really talk about the ones we can't, right? We make a lot about sins that we can see with our eyes, but we rarely talk about the deception that's inside of us. We rarely talk about the greed that is inside of us. We rarely talk about the lies that we tell ourselves. We rarely talk about our misuse of money that comes from a heart inside of us. We, just like the society around Mary and Joseph, tend to make judgments about the obvious mistakes we can see. And this was no different. Mary is now pregnant, and that goes against the societal rules. It goes against the ritual rules. It goes against the religious rules. And what does this mean? What are the consequences at this moment? Well, if Joseph joins with her now, if Joseph and Mary come together now and say, well, this is our son, and they try to like spin a story about it to make it okay with everybody, they will be shunned. They will be shunned by their families. They will be shunned by society, because what they will look at is, you have had sex before marriage. All right? And to that, in that society, that's a no-no. Joseph has a temptation at this moment. We have to be honest, this is a temptation that comes to all of us. He is tempted in this moment, and he struggles with it, to move towards his own power so that he can extricate himself from the problem. Has that ever happened to you? Have you ever seen a problem and you struggle with the fact that you could actually extricate yourself and say, well, this isn't my problem, that's their problem, and I'm just going to go over here and let them take care of it? Has that ever, temptation ever been in your lap ever? That's where Joseph is at right now. The temptation for Joseph is to say maybe one of the following things. Maybe saying, well, you know, this is Mary's problem, right? Mary's the one who's pregnant. Mary's the one who obviously crossed the line. I could say, I don't want to be with her anymore. She crossed the line. It's not my child, which technically, people would accept as true. And Joseph could say, I want nothing to do with this. And society would greet him with respect, greet him with blessing. They would say, oh, we understand. We're so sorry that that happened to you. And no judgment would be held on him. It's tempting. It makes his life simpler. It makes his life less dramatic. Joseph struggles with it. The judgment that he's going to receive, even if he takes Mary as his wife. There will always be questions following them their entire marriage. Questions following this child its entire life. It was the child out of wedlock. It was the bastard child. They will have to face it every single family gathering that they have. Have you ever experienced that? You have a sin in the past that the family knows, and every time you go to a family gathering, somebody gives you the side eye about it. Somebody has to bring it up again. Somebody always has to remind you that though you're there, you are not the favorite, you are not the loved child because of it. It's always held over your head. Joseph is facing that. Even if he decides to step into this, he's going to have to live with that, and so will this child. Joseph struggles with the fact that this child isn't his. This child is not his biologically. And Joseph struggles. Can imagine, just from having friends that have had situations that are similar. There's questions of, is this child ever going to be able to love me? Can I ever love this child? Every time I look at this child, would I think of the fact that I wasn't part of the creation of this child? It creates a lot of questions and emotions around the subject. And it's easy to say, well, he should just adopt him. But that doesn't give the fairness to the human struggle that's happening in this moment. Joseph struggles so much that God has to send a messenger to him. I mean, that tells you the level and the degree of struggle and temptation that Joseph was having. That God has to intervene in this moment and have an angel go, whoa, 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 guy. Like, no, let me tell you what happened here. Her baby is a product of the Holy Spirit. And this is the Messiah. You're going to name him Jesus, which means the one who saves. You're going to name him the one who saves because that's exactly what he's going to do. And it's from that dream, from that moment, that intervention of God, that Joseph says, okay. And he takes Mary as his wife and he steps into this role. He steps into this life where he is going to have to be the protector of God in the most vulnerable form. You know, everyone is looking in that moment at Joseph. Everybody's looking in that moment at Joseph, and all heaven is watching. And as Joseph chooses to obey in that moment, as he chooses to listen to God and obey, Joseph takes the form of a servant. He takes the form of a servant to God. And he rejects the temptation to move with the power that's being offered to him. He takes the form of a servant, which is going to, he's going to become the father of Jesus. And his entire role is going to be to love this child, to help raise God. Think about that. You're going to have to help raise God. That is overwhelming. He is going to have to protect and provide. Joseph becomes a servant, much like his son does, as he emptied himself and becomes like a bondservant. Now, I think we look for power to be on display. That's what we expect in our world. We expect that if you have power, you will use it, you will display it, you will flex your muscles with it. But God's greatest power is not using the power that he has. It's being with us, experiencing our struggle, about coming into humanity, about feeling our journey that we have in which we are constantly being tempted to take the very things that God gifted to us, our voice, our hearts, and even our power. And use it in ways that benefit us at the expense of the others around us. God comes into the house of humanity in this moment, and instead of snapping his fingers to clean the house, and instead of declaring it clean with his words and making it clean, instead of firing all of the servants of the house, God walks into the house of humanity. He puts on the clothes of the servant, and he gets down on his hands and his knees, and he starts scrubbing. And even as he does that, he feels the ache in his body. He feels the burn of his muscles. He feels the soreness over time. He feels the temptation to give up. We see that happen in the garden. It feels the temptation to walk away or to give in to the power being offered. We see that happen as Satan meets Jesus out in the desert and tempts him to use his power to feed himself or to care for himself or to save himself. You know, for us, the invitation today is to allow Christ into some of the deepest places inside of us that we have been keeping away from company, that we have been afraid to let other people see and even let God see about us. They're the places we shove all of the junk in our lives. They're the places we take our emotions and just shove them in because we feel like we can't be honest about them, or we don't want other people to see them, or we just don't want to think about them. Maybe today you are saying, Pastor, I can't let God into that place. I feel so vulnerable to even think about that place myself. To which I say, okay, maybe just say that in a prayer to God. If you're not ready to let him in, talk to him about the vulnerability you're feeling. God, I don't want to let you in. I feel so vulnerable about this. I don't want you to see the truth about me because I don't even love this part of me. Start there. Maybe today you have a place inside of you that you feel guilty and ashamed of. Something you have been walking around with and carrying. That if all of humanity were looking at you and watching a replay of your life and they saw this moment, you would just be humiliated. Let Christ in there. Let God in there. Let him see it. Shine that light on it. Get it out into the light so that God can begin healing it. There's a difference between guilt and shame. Guilt says what you're doing probably isn't right. But shame says something's wrong with you. And that is not helpful. That is a destructive emotion. Let God in there. Let God discern those things and begin to start helping you and healing you today. Maybe you are walking around and you haven't been able to let God into the places of your failures. The places where you feel like you have let people down, you've let God down, you've just done things so wrong and you've damaged or destroyed friendships, relationships, people. It's time to let God in. It's time to let him start redeeming and shining light in that place. Maybe it's your successes you haven't been willing to let God in. Maybe you're feeling like your successes of life are yours, that you accomplished them with your own power, and God doesn't need to be anywhere near that. My finances are a result of my own success in this world, and they're mine to spend as I please. Or I accomplished everything I have on my own successes. I'm the greatest. I don't need God to help me in this place. I'm good without him. If you're in that type of a place, I implore you, please let God in. If for nothing else, to taste a little bit of humility. He can't be God with us if we aren't willing to let him into the whole house. If we're only letting him be the God of the foyer, or even the God of the porch, or the God of the doorway in our lives, then he's really not Emmanuel with us. God came into this world to be Emmanuel, not just to wave to us from afar, not just to see us on the cross, hanging and looking at us and pray for our forgiveness. He came to be with us even now. And so our invitation today isn't just to sit at the table to dine with Christ, as we will in a few minutes. Our invitation is to invite him into our house, into every single room. Highs, lows, and the places that are so dark, even the darkest places and moments of our lives, that his little light can begin to make a difference. That the depths of the love of Christ might make us whole and heal us. Let's pray. God, we thank you for your amazing gift of love that saw our condition and decided to do something about it. That you saw our poorness of spirit. You saw our heinous impulses to hurt those less than us. You saw our judgment that cast people out, that shunned people. You saw our murderous hearts that damage and hurt one another. You saw the injustice that was happening. And you left your throne and you came for us to be with us, to be Emmanuel, that no matter what we are going through, you have known it, you have tasted it, and you have shown us a way in which to walk. So we pray, O God, in this day, help us to receive your light into the depths of our life and help us to be a light in some of the darkest moments of other people's. And it's our call to be servants of God and to walk in a servant way. So let us lay down our lives this day and put on the clothes of a servant, get down on our hands and knees, and scrub, that we might serve our fellow people, serve those in our community, our friends, our family, our enemies alike, that we might reflect Christ and walk in his way. We ask this in your holy name. Amen. I invite you to reflect on our message today through this video.
God, why do you love us? Have you looked down here lately? Have you seen the mess we have made of the gifts you gave us? We're like bad children who break their toys and demand more. And you love us. You don't say, "Don't touch the stove," and then we scream for you when we get burned. And still you love us. You don't turn your back on us, even when we turn our backs on each other. Where does this love come from? Where can we learn to love like this? Anger is easy, but love? Fear, frustration, suffering, we've got these. But love, your kind of love, how is that even possible? We see the places that are empty. We see the places where love can make a difference. Is that what you saw, God? Is that what you see now? Is that why you sent your son? This candle of love, this light, shows us where to give love, shows us the empty spaces in the world and in each other. When we share love, we are sharing God. Join with me as we confess our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
I invite you to draw your bread and cup near to you at this time as we come to the table of the Lord. We are invited to come to the table of the one who holds all authority and all power in the universe, who left his throne to come and dine with you and I, to sit at the table, to eat, to drink with us, to converse with us, to listen, to speak to us. The one who came to die for us. He came so that you and I might have life. He came that we might be given grace. So let's come to the table today and have a taste of the meal that is yet to come and receive once again that incredible grace of God poured out for all of us as we remember God in this meal. Join with me in a prayer. You are holy, O God of majesty. Jesus Christ, you are the Blessed One. In love with you and in compassion for all, Jesus healed and taught, challenged and comforted, welcomed and saved. He formed a community promising to be with his disciples wherever two or three or more were gathered, and sending them on his mission of hope and healing in the world, Jesus trusted his life to you, O God, and went freely to his death, so that the world might be set free from suffering and sin. You raised him from death, and you raise us also to live in new life with him. In the power of the Holy Spirit, you send us out to make disciples as he commanded. Remembering all of your mighty and your merciful acts, we take this bread and this wine from the gifts you have given us and celebrate with joy the redemption won for us in Christ. Accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, as a living and holy offering of ourselves, that our lives may proclaim the one crucified and risen. For great is the mystery of our faith, that Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread which we break and the cup that we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. And by your Spirit, unite us with the living Christ, with all who are baptized in his name, that we may be one in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. It's also our day to give thanks to you, O God, for the life and the witness of those who have died. We hold them in our hearts this day, and we rejoice knowing that they are with you. God, today you have called us together to be the church. So unite us now at your table in one loaf and in a common cup. Make us one in Christ Jesus. Let your Spirit empower the life we share and ignite our witness in the world. With all that have gone before us, keep us faithful to the gospel teachings and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayers, and give us the strength to serve you until the promised day of resurrection, when the redeemed of all ages, we will feast with you at your table in glory. Through Christ, all glory and honor are yours, O God, with the Holy Spirit and the Holy Church, now and forever. Amen. When Christ was with his disciples, sharing what would be their final meal together before he went to the cross, he supped with them. He dined with them at the table. And after the meal, he took the bread on the table that was left. He lifted it. He gave thanks for it. He broke it. And he said, "This is my body broken in love for you. Take and eat." In the same manner, he took the cup. He lifted it, and he blessed it, saying, "This is the cup of my new covenant poured out. Take and drink, and do all this in remembrance of me." So today, I invite you to take a piece of your bread today and taste of the grace of God given for you. Take your cup at this time and drink of the blessing of God, his new covenant of life for us. For as often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim the risen Christ, the one who will come again. Let's come together and lift our community in prayer today. Let's lift our hearts to God, rejoicing in his grace, rejoicing in his love, rejoicing in his blessing and sacrifice for you and I. Let's pray. O God, on this second Sunday of Advent, we ponder our human predicament. Recognizing how often we find ourselves overwhelmed by circumstances, stuck in ditches of various sorts, or given to aimless meandering on paths that lead nowhere, or buried under by seemingly insurmountable challenges and obstacles. And yet, you have promised to lift every valley, straighten the crooked path, and level the mountains in order to come to us and lead us home. We hear your promises, O God. Empower us by your Spirit to see the way you have set before us. Empower us as a community of faith to accompany one another on the journey. Help us to listen to each other with compassion when we feel fearful or angry or lost. And help us to recognize your tender love that is ever before us. Help us to believe the good news of the gospel, that we are not left to our own devices. You have not left us in the ditch or aimlessly wandering in exile. You have come close in the incarnate Christ, one with human face who has left a footprint for us to follow. We pray for the world of nations, including our own, as we continue to grapple with a relentless pandemic. We pray especially for the vulnerable among us, for medical professionals and staff, for essential workers, for parents with school-age children, for the elderly, and for those with pre-existing health conditions. O God, help us to live responsibly in ways that protect the well-being of others. We pray for all who are grieving the loss of loved ones during these difficult days. We pray that you would grant wisdom to the leadership of our communities, our cities, our states, our countries, the nations of this world, that they may discern a path forward in these perilous times. Indeed, grant all of us wisdom and courage for living in these days. We pray for these things in the name of the one who taught us how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Please join us in singing our closing hymn today. Let's bow our heads to receive a blessing as we go. Comfort, comfort my people, says the Lord. So stand on the promise that every valley shall be lifted up, every mountain and hill will be made low, and the uneven ground will become level, and the rough places a plain. Stand on the promise that the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and that all people will see it. We trust this promise today So go and share this promise with all that you meet, all that you speak to, all that you pray for. Alleluia. Amen. Thank you for joining us today. We pray that you have a blessed day.